Hello and welcome. Indian companies, let's talk about Indian IT companies, face two kinds of challenges on the skill side. One is young people who come into the workforce and have to be trained to meet the needs of what companies need or their customers need. The second is the middle management, and this gets a little tricky because these are people who've been working for maybe a decade or two decades and have to reskill themselves, otherwise they find themselves out of a job. So can we draw a parallel in some ways with another world? And let's try that by talking to Gopichand P, a well-known badminton coach and player. Thank you very much for speaking with us. So, you know, I'm talking to you in the context of a technology conference, but this the worlds are in some ways similar in terms of the challenges faced. You know, and I would maybe urge you to look at this middle management skill challenge, which is, you know, how do people who've done one kind of thing for a long time change? And how do they motivate themselves to do it? Should they be looking for coaches, life coaches? How do they give themselves up in a way that they can actually achieve this transformation?
Well, I think in quite a similar circumstance, when you look at sports persons who start off, they start playing at a certain style, at a certain type because of their strengths naturally. As competition grows, as their own strengths and weaknesses differ depending on age groups. If there's a 15-year-old kid playing, he would be playing on skill or strength. But as you grow higher and as you grow older and people get stronger and opposition gets stronger, when you're 19 and you have to play more mature players, you need to kind of mentally align yourself very differently. Mm. And you probably are winning for 5 years or 10 years and people have figured you out. Mm. And that is when you have to make a total transformation again, because to win again, you need to kind of reconstruct yourself. And some of it might be actually questioning your fundamentals, your foundations, changing the very basics of what you've learned, mm. consciously doing what has got you results till then. But now you're going to change it because the world knows what you are doing and you need to change that. So fundamentally, there's a lot of change which is needed to stay on top of the competition. So that's very important from a sport perspective. And I guess from a world perspective or from a corporate perspective, as you've said, I think the best people are the ones who keep unlearning and learning new things without actually fearing failure. Mm. And that, I think, is very, very critical.
Right. So the sporting world is obviously more brutal, and you know, results are quick and outcomes are immediate. But tell us, how would you, if faced with a situation like this, you know, there is a young person who comes to you, you know, who's completed 5 years, as you said, has been on a winning streak, but is now requires that crucial retraining because everyone has figured this player out. So where do you begin?
I think the foundations need to be questioned, and we need to start from the very basics of what we are. And you have to be ready to experiment. You also have to be ready to accept the fact that the experiment might not give you the best results in the first place. And it's important to also get you the right kind of people, because in life, it's easy to do trial and error, but trial and error is a method which actually takes a lot of time. Mm. So if you have expertise, I think it will be very, very helpful in ensuring that this process happens faster than if there is no coach or help at hand.
Mm-hmm. So the mental block is the first part, right?
The willingness to change, the motivation to change, the thing that I need to change is what is important. Okay. Many of the times people have this challenge that I have done this all my life, I have been successful, I don't want to change, kind of a thing. I think that needs to be fundamentally moved and said, we need to be ready to understand that I might be wrong, things are different now, and I need to, in terms of competition, to be better than them, I need to ensure that I need to revamp myself. And that innate motivation is very, very important. And then you start looking at areas which need to be changed, and change is uncomfortable. So you need to be ready to make that uncomfortable things, start liking them, start working on them, start experimenting on them. At the end of it, going and challenging bigger things with the newfound weapons.
So what's a good example that you can quote from either people you work with or yourself in your own transitions?
I think lot of players, when, for example, we had a system change from 15 points to a 7 points to a 21 points, it's like out of the blue somebody has changed the goalpost. Mm. And you as a top player need to kind of maneuver and change yourself. Or you have times when there was no draft on the stadiums and shuttles were slow. Suddenly air conditions were introduced and then you play in conditions which are windy. Mm. So suddenly what you have been taught of as your good big long follow through is now cut short to very short follow through to ensure that your accuracy is more because the shuttle is drifting all over the place. You need to just kind of put it in. And your thinking is very different from what it used to be. So these are things which have happened and players have adapted. They always, the top players are the ones who have adapted. And adaptation happens, conditions, formats, opposition, all of these things, or our own difficulties. People would have, say, a particular kind of a problem in terms of a physical injury or something, and they would use technical things to in their game to change so that that weakness is covered by their technique. So these are things which players consistently have to do to stay on top of the game.
Right. So let me switch gears a little bit. I've talked about maybe older people, or as you've said, you know, people with 5 or 6 years of successful runs, and I've talked about older managers and them trying to reskill. But let's talk about young people, you know, spotting talent, and this is something that you do all the time. So what are you looking for? What are the 3 or 4 things that you look for when you actually decide to work with someone and train them onwards?
Involvement is very, very important. I think if you get people who are involved in doing stuff, who are engrossed in doing tasks, who love doing it with enthusiasm despite failing, these are the people who have the best chances of succeeding. Mm-hmm. As coaches who work, I think it's very important that instead of only focusing on seeing whether the student is talented or not, it would be important to put the onus on us and believe that he is talented, and we need to map where his best talents are. To give an example, maybe we are looking at somebody in programming in an office, but his strengths are in sales or his strengths are in HR, and where do you map it? So believe that each kid is talented, each student is talented, each employee is talented, and put the onus on ourselves to ensure that we need to ensure that we give him a space and a place which where he is motivated and where his best outputs are given. So if we take that direction, then I think it's the onus is on us rather than brushing aside people saying that they are not talented.
Right, but you must be saying no to people as well. So on how often do you do that and what do you say?
Well, definitely in a sport with limited opportunities and infra, it's a tough call whenever we have to say that. But for me, I would go ahead and think that every kid is talented, and definitely when you are looking at producing Olympic medalists, you need to look at the physical, the ability to convert winnable matches into proper wins, and to ensure that people consistently and continuously stay motivated. So these are the things which I would see when I'm looking at people whom I work on a long-term basis.
So if I were to look forward and say, okay, how do we build the next generation of great medal-winning badminton players? What would your wish list be?
I think the 3 things which I think would be important to widen the net of people who would play sport. From a young age, kids are physically literate. Kids are going through physical movements in a pattern which is organized. They follow tenets of proper scientific long-term athlete development. So we have a large group of playing sport till at least about 15 years of age. And then the best kids out of those groups are picked up and then given the best of facilities and ensured that they are given an opportunity to be the best in the world. So that's the kind of things I would look at it from my wish list as such. And it doesn't end there. My wish list would also not be complete if I do not accept the fact that for every champion who's made, there are a lot of them who are not made as well. So it's very important for us that all of them are close the loop by ensuring that all of them are educated enough, are provided basic structures so that they have good a life even if they don't make it as top players in the sport.
Right, and the last point, let me just pick on that. Is that you feel that because of your own experience in transition, because you've made a good transition and maybe other people have not?
Well, I've been very fortunate, God has been kind, but it's not the case that many of my fellow players have not made it to the top, or many of them have gone ahead and done are doing jobs where their heart is not there. So I would really wish that all of them do what they're good at. And yes, it is not a crime to not succeed in sport, because there's so many aspects which are related to sport. And I think it's very important that the society, the sporting administration should ensure that they are given proper jobs and proper life skills, so that they return back and contribute back to the society in different ways in which they are happy.
Right, Gopichand, what a busy season coming up. All the best, and thank you very much for speaking with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.